Yes, sir. But yes, to elect a chairman and a vice chairman.
Okay.
For the next 12 months. And sure. So I'd like to open the floor for nominations for the office of chairman for the Civil Service Board. Is there any nominations?
I nominate Mr. Terry Smith.
Okay.
Thank you for the job he's been doing for us.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
I abstain.
Okay. Sorry. I'm writing
it's
in.
Okay. It's okay. It's
okay. Okay, so we have, are there any more nominations? Okay, if not, we'll close the nominations. And is there a motion to elect Mr. Terry Smith as chairman to the Civil Service Board for the next calendar year?
So moved.
Okay. Is there a second?
No.
Second.
Okay. So there's a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Again, I abstain.
Okay. So two in favor and one abstain. That's the majority. So congratulations, Mr. Smith.
Our condolences.
Okay. And now we will open the floor for nominations for vice chairman.
I nominate Dr. A.Y. Howell.
Okay. So there's a nomination for Dr. Howell. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. A motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
You abstain?
Abstain.
Okay. And are there any other nominations? Okay. If not, we will close the floor for that. And I will call for a vote for, is there a motion to elect Dr. Howell as vice chairman?
So moved. Second.
Okay. I have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay. All right. Okay. Well, two in favor, one abstain.
Right.
The majority here, so congratulations, Dr. Howell, you're the vice chairman.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Clark, for handling that.
You're welcome.
We're going to move to item number four, which is the Walter Skowronski hearing that was supposed to be held today. Our hearing officer and general counsel is going to go into the details of what's transpired for the past couple of weeks. I would say this, that Mr. Rich and I have talked, and Mr. Neville and I have talked, and at any time that he feels that this is getting to where legal advice should be given to the board, we may stop it right there and go into executive session. I would hope that we keep it on the record and we can not go into executive session, but I don't want to endanger the integrity of the board and any decisions that we might make. So with that caveat, I'm going to turn it over to Rich.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. As you know, that we had Walter Skowronski's appeal scheduled for today for a hearing. We received a letter on July the 2nd from Mr. Brian Hansford and Logan Butler, who represent the sheriff. And in the letter, it stated that the sheriff desired to have his attorney present at the hearing representing the sheriff in the presentation of the sheriff's case, which would also include questioning Mr. Skowronski and presenting the case on behalf of the sheriff. The rules of the Civil Service Board state that it's section, or it's policy 5, section 8 states that the county attorney will not represent any county actor at a hearing unless the appellant first indicates that he or she will use counsel. We notified Mr. Skowronski prior to the hearing and asked him if he intended to have an attorney. He said he would not have one. And based on that, we advised the sheriff that there would not be an attorney appearing on his behalf. So up until July 2nd, we were going to handle this hearing like I assume that the board always has. If the appellant doesn't ask for an attorney, then there would not be an attorney present. The sheriff is now saying, well, I want my attorney here. So I think, been faced with something the board's probably never encountered before, and that is, what does the board do with this situation? We have a rule that the board, this board, did not make. We are trying to apply rules that the Forsyth County Board of Commissioners made for us. And it appears that the intent of the rule was there would not be an attorney representing the county actor if the appellant did not have an attorney there. So that's clearly the intent. The argument by the sheriff is that his attorney is not the county attorney, and so therefore this provision doesn't apply to him. So I think the board at this point has to decide which route are we going to take. Are we going to follow the intent of the civil service rules and simply tell the sheriff that the intent of the rule is that an attorney would not be present and therefore he cannot have an attorney there, or should we allow him to have an attorney and proceed with the hearing? So that's the issue before the board. If anybody has any questions.
You know, I believe everybody has the right to an attorney, but the civil service policy 5, section 8A is very clear. And there is a reason for guidelines and policies, and that's to take human judgment out of it. And to deviate from that, I think, would set a precedent and would not be the most prudent thing for this board. These policies are in place, and they were set forth by the Board of Commissioners, and I think we need to abide by them. And with all due respect to the sheriff's legal counsel, you know, what is the definition of the county attorney? Is the county attorney the attorney that represents the Board of Commissioners, or an attorney that represents the county agency? And in my opinion, if a county agency has an attorney, that's clearly a county attorney. And I would, my opinion is we need to follow the policy set forth by the Board of Commissioners to the letter.
When I have this part, Dr. Howell and I were involved in these when the county redid the guidelines for the Civil Service Board. It had gotten to the point to where it was becoming awfully expensive to have a civil service hearing. You had attorneys on both sides, sometimes multiple attorneys, and it was, you know, the commissioners made the decision that if we could cut down on legal costs, then that's the way we would do it. Up until this rule came out, if the appellant did not have an attorney, the county would still supply attorneys, and it was costing a lot of money, and therefore the commissioner said if we can cut back on costs, then that's what we're going to do, and that's why they instituted this rule. Am I correct on that, Dr. Allen? That's the way you interpreted it. So that's kind of where it is. And Dr. Howell, do you have a comment or anything that you want to make on it?
I cannot conceive a fellow who's come up here for this board and he has not been asked if you want to have an agency to ask weeks before, are you going to have an attorney?
Yes, sir.
Away from that, if they did, we know what we had. So I think it's, to me, to have an appellant who's not been told or asked if you want to have an attorney, I think since we're going that route, if you don't do what we've been doing, then we're not only judging him, but we're hanging him. It's just not over.
I agree.
Well, if the word gets out that we're going to allow our appellant to have an attorney, I think we'll get a lot more to make sure. I'm all for kind of saving money, but at the same time, it's not getting any deeper into the problem. So I'm doing something. I think they should know, they should ask. I thought when they went through this thing that the sheriff or whoever was hearing it always ask, are you going to have an attorney? I haven't seen anything there about that.
Mr. Skowronski, were you, at your pre-dismissal hearing, were you told of the fact that if you didn't want an attorney, there wouldn't be one representing the county?
Once I was told, Ms. Clark called and said that the board would hear my appeal. I was told then that if I didn't have an attorney, then the sheriff's department wouldn't be using an attorney as well.
Okay.
If I had one, that they could use one.
Okay.
And being unemployed, I don't have the money for one.
Okay.
I will add, we had a conference call with Mr. Skowronski and Mr. Butler yesterday. And Mr. Skowronski, I told him what had happened as far as this letter from the sheriff. And so he asked for a continuance of the hearing, and that was unopposed by Mr. Butler. So the hearing is, we probably need to talk about reset of the hearing day, which I guess our next meeting is August the 8th. But so that's another issue. But and also, if the board has any questions about the legal analysis of this, I can try to answer those as well. I just would recommend we probably go into executive session if the board desires to hear that.
I don't think we need to do that. There's one other issue that I would like to address, and that is the clock is ticking. The Civil Service Board has 120 days from the date that the appeal is filed. Am I correct?
That is correct.
And we don't know where this is going to go. And I would like to say that we will freeze the clock as of today, and we will start it back ticking again when we schedule the hearing. Once we start that hearing, I don't know where this will go or how long it'll take. We will set another hearing, but I don't know whether that hearing will take place or not. So any motions that are made, I'd like to, you know, when we make those motions. Let's address, first of all, Civil Service Board going to abide by the Civil Service guidelines, or are we going to deviate from them? The chair will entertain any motion that wants to be made at this time.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we continue going to federal tax.
Okay.
Second.
There's a motion and a second that the Civil Service Board will abide by the guidelines, and that if the employee, if I can add a little to it, it means that in this case, if the appellate doesn't have an attorney, then the opposing department or agency will not have an attorney present. Is that correct? Is that the way you want it read?
Yeah, yes.
Okay.
Yes, got it. So I agree with that.
Motion and a second to that motion. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. I would suggest, gentlemen, that we set the next hearing for Mr. Skowronski on August, what day would that be? August the 8th, 2013 at 9:30. We will have our meeting first. That will be our regular meeting day, and we'll begin the hearing immediately afterwards, which should be approximately 10 o'clock. I hear a motion to that effect.
I motion to that effect, Mr. Chairman.
Second. Motion and second that the hearing will be rescheduled for 9:30 August the 8th. 2013, immediately after our regular meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries. I'd like to have another motion made that the clock be frozen for Mr. Skowronski as far as 120 days, and we'll begin the click again on August the 8th.
So move.
A second.
Motion and second that the clock be frozen until August the 8th. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Ms. Clark, are you getting all that?
Who made that last motion? I'm sorry.
I did.
Okay. Thank you.
We get going pretty fast here.
Okay.
Are we up to date?
We are.
Okay, gentlemen, is there anything else that needs to come before the board at this time?
No.
No. Mr. Perry?
No, sir.
No, sir.
Ms. Clark?
No, sir.
Okay. I hear a motion to adjourn.
So
motion in a second. If we adjourn, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Motion carries unanimously. Thank y'all for coming.
Before you go, please, we'll find the amendments.
sir.
Have a good day.
You too.
Thank you, and I'll give you the letter out. I'll set you with the new hearing.
Okay, I appreciate that.
Thank you.
That's good. Thank you, sir. Have a good day.
Yeah.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Anytime, thank you for having us.
Okay.
Good to see you, Tim.
Terry, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. See you down the park.
Should be.
It's already been.
I've got four cases.
I just want to get, I know, trust me, something I have to do.
It'll be different from last time.
No frost talking on the blue board.
He does have a very high style.
But that was one of them. It's just, that's our brother.
Not probably.
I hope that they.
But that won't be as big as last time.
Yeah, I got my head.
I'm important. 9:45.
10:00. Well, 9:45.
City court.
We had three trials the week, the month before.
City court. Month before, we're there about after 10.
Tisdale, how you doing?
Dr. Howell, you started 30 minutes earlier today.
We have a hearing. We start 30 minutes earlier.
This is me.
Thank you for reminding me.
Charles, when I was here.
That's what the stars do. Well, I was most interested in the hearing.
Well, you have a big day.
That works as well.
He didn't cry.
But he was close. Charles always carries the same. I love doing Charles because he's so entertaining.
Yeah.
I think I'll do what's.
Okay. So he was arguing about the home depot policies, and so everybody was invoking Bernie Marcus. Who was it? Arthur Blank. Yeah, Arthur Blank would roll over if he knew what home depot was doing.
It was a good.
Nobody said it was one that, you know, the city wasn't comfortable dismissing it. As a defense attorney, I have to try, you know, but as the prosecutor, I would dismiss it. It was a good trial case. It was a good prayer.
Well, I'm glad you did it. I mean, yeah. But on the level that we have to have this trial.
All right, well, head back to his office.
Good to meet you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you, sir.
My pleasure. Take care of yourself. Yes, sir. I will. My pleasure, too.
Mr. Tisdale.
You have a good afternoon.
And how are you?
Jared, it's good to see you.
That's all right.
Take care.
Well, that's okay. That's okay. You're welcome anytime.
Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm good.
You know, this floor, open the hall and this out here.
Okay, Mr. Clark. Did you learn anything yesterday?
I did. We talked about security. Kennesaw.
Nice to see you.
Good to see you. Thank you for having me.
Good day.
Okay, y'all too.
A really good school safety and security. Goodbye, Mr. Neville.
All right, have a good day.
See you next month.